Give and Take: A Revolutionary Approach to Success. Author: Adam Grant. Chapter 9. Out of the Shadows. Some people, when they do someone a favor, are always looking for a chance to call it in. And some aren't, but they are still aware of it, still regarded as a debt. But others don't even do that. They're like a vine that produces grapes without looking for anything in return. After helping others, they just go on to something else. We should be like that. Marcus Aurelius, Roman Emperor. A number of years ago, an imposing figure made his mark on the sports world. Well over 6 feet tall and 200 pounds, Derek Sorensen was a tough, aggressive competitor who struck fear into the hearts of his opponents. He led his NCAA team to a national championship and went on to play in the pros. After his career was cut short by an injury, he was courted by the finest professional teams in his sport to become a contract negotiator. He would be wheeling and dealing with players and agents in the hopes of building a world-class team. To sharpen his bargaining skills, Derek enrolled in a negotiation course at a leading business school. During each class session, he had the chance to practice negotiating in a variety of roles, ranging from a pharmaceutical executive trying to buy a manufacturing plant to a condo developer in a heated dispute with a carpenter. In one of his earliest negotiations, Derek bought a property as a real estate investment, and in top taker form, he persuaded the listing agent to sell at a price that went directly against her client's interests. On an icy winter evening, Derek played the role of one of 4 fishermen who ran competing businesses. They were overfishing to the point that the resource would become extinct, and they sat down to discuss how they should handle the dilemma. One negotiator suggested that they should split the maximum total fishing in 4 equal parts. Another proposed a different way of matching, based on equity rather than equality. Since some of them were running larger operations than others, they should each reduce their fishing by 50%. They all agreed that this was a fair solution, and the meeting was adjourned. Now, it was up to each negotiator to make an individual decision about whether to honor the agreement and how much to fish. 2 of the negotiators stuck to their commitments, reducing their fishing by 50%. The 3rd operated like a giver. She reduced her fishing by 65%. The group was all set to keep the resource intact, but Derek chose not to reduce his fishing at all. He took as much as he could, actually increasing his fishing total and decimating the other 3 entrepreneurs. Before the group met, Derek had the lowest profits of the 4. After he took far more than his share of the harvest, his profits were 70% higher than the givers and 31% higher than those of the other 2. When confronted by his colleagues, Derek responded, "I wanted to win the negotiations and destroy my competitors." Just a few months later, Derek began a meteoric rise in his career. He was hired by a professional sports team and established a reputation as a dominant negotiator, playing a key role in assembling a team that went on to win a world championship. Derek was promoted in an unusually short period of time and recognized as one of the 100 most powerful people in his sport while still in his 30s. When Derek first started working for his team as a professional negotiator, his job was to manage the budget, identify top prospects, and negotiate contracts with agents to sign new players and keep existing players. Since resources were tight, bargaining like a taker would work to his advantage. Derek began to search for underrated talent and stumbled upon a gem of a player in the minor leagues. He sat down with the player's agent to negotiate a contract. True to form, Derek made a lowball offer. The agent was frustrated. Several comparable players were earning higher salaries. The agent accused Derek of pushing him around and demanded more money, but Derek ignored the demands and didn't budge. Eventually, the agent gave in and agreed to Derek's terms. It was a win for Derek, saving his team thousands of dollars. But when Derek went home that night, he had an uneasy feeling. I could just feel through the conversation that he was pretty upset. He brought up a couple points on comparable players, and in the heat of things, I probably wasn't listening too much. He was going away with a bad taste in his mouth. Derek decided he didn't want to end the exchange with the agent on a sour note. So, he tore up the contract and met the agent's original request, giving him thousands of extra dollars for the player. Was this a wise decision? Derek was costing his team money and potentially creating a precedent for doing so in other negotiations. Besides, the deal was settled. The agent had agreed to the lowball offer and Derek had achieved his goal. Going back on it hardly seemed like a smart move. Actually, it was much smarter than it first appeared. When Vanderbilt researchers Bruce Berry and Ray Friedman studied negotiations, they had a hunch that sharper negotiators would get better results, as they could gather and analyze more information, keep track of multiple issues, and generate hidden solutions. In one study, Berry and Friedman obtained data on the intelligence of nearly 100 MBA students. They measured intelligence using each student's score on the GMAT, a rigorous test that is widely used in business school admissions to measure quantitative, verbal, and analytical abilities. The participants negotiated in pairs, playing either the developer of a new mall or the representative of a potential store to anchor the mall. After they finished negotiating, they submitted their final agreements, and two experts assessed the value of the deal to each party. As expected, the joint gains were highest when both parties were very intelligent. Berry and Friedman broke down each party's gains, expecting to find that the smarter negotiators got better deals for themselves. But they didn't. The brightest negotiators got better deals for their counterparts. The smarter negotiator appears to be able to understand his or her opponent's true interests and thus, to provide them with better deals at little cost to him or herself. Berry and Friedman write. The more intelligent you are, the more you help your counterpart succeed. This is exactly what Derek did when he gave the agent more money for the minor league player. He was giving in an offerish way that was low cost to him, but high benefit to the agent and the player. A few thousand dollars were small potatoes to his team, but very significant to the player. What drove Derek to shift in the giver direction? Shortly before the negotiation with the agent, Derek had gained a window into something that mattered deeply to him, his reputation. At the end of the negotiation course, every participant submitted votes for negotiation awards. Derek received 0 votes for most cooperative, 0 for most creative, and 0 for most ethical. In fact, there was only one award for which he received any votes. For this particular award, Derek received the vast majority of the votes. He was the landslide winner for most ruthless. But Derek achieved something more memorable that week. He became the only student in business school history to be voted the most ruthless negotiator in a class that he never took. At the same time that he was enrolled in his course, another negotiation class was underway. None of these students in the other class ever sat across the bargaining table from Derek. Some of them had never met him. Yet his reputation spread so quickly that they voted for him as most ruthless anyway. Derek was negotiating the way any reasonable person would in a taker's world. As a professional athlete, he had learned that if he didn't claim as much value as possible, he was at risk for becoming a doormat. It was the team against the player. The team was always trying to take money out of my pocket, so I viewed negotiation to be a combative process, which produced a winner and a loser, Derek says. I had to try to take more and more. After being anointed the most ruthless negotiator by his peers and a group of strangers, Derek began to reflect on his reciprocity style at the bargaining table. While I gained a short-term benefit by taking, in the long run I paid. My relationship with a colleague was ruined, and it caused the demise of my reputation, he said. In the negotiation with the agent, when he ripped up the contract and gave the agent more money, it built goodwill. The agent was extremely appreciative, Derek reflects. When the player came up for free agency, the agent gave me a call. Looking back on it now, I'm really glad I did it. It's definitely improved our relationship and helped out our organization. Maybe most ruthless is maturing. Actually, I believe maturing is the wrong way to describe Derek's transformation. Maturation implies a process of growth and development, but in a sense, Derek was actually taking a step backward to express core values that he had embraced 4 years away from the bargaining table. Long before he ever negotiated like a taker, his peers perceived him as a generous, helpful person who would make time for anyone who asked. He spent countless hours providing advice to colleagues who were interested in sports management careers and mentoring young athletes who aspired to follow in his footsteps. Growing up, he was elected captain of virtually every team on which he played, from elementary school through high school, all the way through college. He even became captain as a rookie on his first professional team. Players twice his age respected his commitment to putting the team's interests ahead of his own. At the bargaining table, Derek's transition wasn't about learning a new set of values. It was about developing the confidence and courage to express an old set of values in a new domain. I believe this is true for most people who operate like matches professionally, and my hope is that others like Derek won't wait for a most ruthless award to start finding ways to act in the interest of others at work. For Derek these days, a signature form of giving is helping opposing teams gather information about players. Even though they are competing in a zero-sum sport, he shares knowledge to help rival teams make good decisions about players who have been on his team in the past. On the field, I want to beat up opposing teams. But off the field, I'm always trying to help them out. Today, Derek attributes his success in building a championship-winning professional sports team to his shift from taking toward giving. Yet he still worries about what will happen if people outside his inner circle find out about his shift in the giver direction. In fact, Derek Sorensen is a pseudonym. Before sharing his story, he asked me to disguise his identity. I don't want it to get out there that I've given more money than I needed to a player, he says. These fears persist among many successful givers, but they are not insurmountable. Consider Sharyan Pless, the financial services executive from the opening chapter who hid the fact that kindness and compassion emerged as her top strengths. When I originally asked her to tell her story, like Derek, she only agreed under the condition that she would remain anonymous. 6 months later, she changed her mind. I started an underground campaign of givers coming out of the closet, she said. Being a giver has contributed to my personal and professional success. It's liberating to talk about it. I'm not afraid anymore. What changed her mind? When Sharyan first recognized her giver attributes, she was focused on the risks. People expected her to be tough and results-oriented, and might see giving as a sign of weakness. But when she started taking a close look around her company, she was struck by the realization that all of her professional role models were givers. Suddenly, her frame of reference shifted. Instead of just seeing givers at the bottom, she recognized a surprising number of givers at the top. This isn't what we usually notice when we glance up at the horizon at successful people. By and large, because of their tendencies toward powerful speech and claiming credit, successful takers tend to dominate the spotlight. But if you start paying attention to reciprocity styles in your own workplace, I have a hunch that you'll discover plenty of givers achieving the success to which you aspire. Personally, the successful people whom I admire most are givers, and I feel that it's my responsibility to try and pass along what I've learned from them. When I arrived at Wharton, my charge was to teach some of the world's finest analytic minds to become better leaders, managers, and negotiators. I decided to introduce them to reciprocity styles, posing the question that animated the introduction to this book: who do you think ends up at the bottom of the success ladder? The verdict was nearly unanimous: givers. When I asked who rises to the top, the students were evenly split between matchers and takers. So, I chose to teach them something that struck them as heretical. You might be underestimating the success of givers, I told them. It's true that some people who consistently help others without expecting anything in return are the ones who fall to the bottom. But this same orientation toward giving, with a few adjustments, can also enable people to rise to the top. Focus attention and energy on making a difference in the lives of others, and success might follow as a byproduct. I knew I was fighting an uphill battle, so I decided to prove them wrong. This book is that proof. Although many of us hold strong giver values, we are often reluctant to express them at work. But the growth of teamwork, service jobs, and social media has opened up new opportunities for givers to develop relationships and reputations that accelerate and amplify their success. We've covered evidence that givers can rise to the top across a stunningly diverse range of occupations, from engineering to medicine to sales. And remember when Peter Audit, the Australian financial advisor, seemed to be wasting hours of his time by driving out to help a poor scrap metal worker manage his money? The client turned out to be the wealthy owner of a scrap metal business, resulting in major gains for Peter's firm, but the story doesn't end there. Peter learned that the scrap metal owner was too busy running the business to take a vacation, and he wanted to help. A few months later, another client expressed that she wasn't happy in her job as a manager at an auto body shop. Peter recommended her to the scrap metal owner, who had a need for her skills, and it turned out that she lived 5 minutes away from the scrap metal yard. She started work 3 weeks later, and the client took his wife on their first vacation in years. Both of these clients are happy and grateful that I think about their whole lives, not just their investments, Peter says. The more I help out, the more successful I become. But I measure success in what it has done for the people around me. That is a real accolade. In the mind of a giver, the definition of success itself takes on a distinctive meaning. Whereas takers view success as attaining results that are superior to others, and matchers see success in terms of balancing individual accomplishments with fairness to others, givers are inclined to follow Peter's lead, characterizing success as individual achievements that have a positive impact on others. Taking this definition of success seriously might require dramatic changes in the way that organizations hire, evaluate, reward, and promote people. It would mean paying attention not only to the productivity of individual people, but also to the ripple effects of this productivity on others. If we broadened our image of success to include contributions to others along with individual accomplishments, people might be motivated to tilt their professional reciprocity styles toward giving. If success required benefiting others, it's possible that takers and matchers would be more inclined to find altruistic ways to advance personal and collective interests simultaneously. The connection between individual and collective success underlies every story of successful givers in this book. As an entrepreneur, Adam Rifkin built his network of influential people by trying to help everyone he met, launching successful companies, and enabling thousands of colleagues to find jobs, develop skills, and start productive businesses along the way. As a venture capitalist, David Hornick invested in lucrative companies and fortified his reputation by helping aspiring entrepreneurs create better pitches and gain funding for their startups. As a comedy writer, George Meier earned Emmys and established a reputation as the funniest writer in Hollywood, while elevating the effectiveness of and opening doors for the people who collaborated with him on Army Man and The Simpsons. In the classroom, CJ Skender earned dozens of teaching awards while inspiring a new generation of students, seeing their potential and motivating them to achieve this potential, and Conry Callahan sustained her energy and was nominated for a national teaching award after she started a non-profit to help underprivileged children prepare for college. In healthcare, Kildare Scotto and Nancy Phelps rose to the top of their company's sales revenue charts by striving to help patients. In consulting, Jason Jeller and Lillian Bohr made partner early by virtue of the contributions that they made through mentoring and developing others, which in turn enriched the knowledge of junior colleagues. In politics, Abraham Lincoln became president and built a legacy as one of the greatest leaders in world history by helping his rivals earn coveted political positions. This is what I find most magnetic about successful givers. They get to the top without cutting others down. Finding ways of expanding the pie that benefit themselves and the people around them. Whereas success is zero-sum in a group of takers, in groups of givers, it may be true that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Armed with this knowledge, I've seen some people become more strategic matchers, helping others in the hopes of developing the relationships and reputations necessary to advance their own success. Can people succeed through instrumental giving, where the primary intent is giving? At the beginning of the book, I suggested that in the long term, the answer might be no. There's a fine line between giving and clever matching, and this line blurs depending on whether we define reciprocity styles by the actions themselves, the motives behind them, or some combination of the two. It's a deep philosophical question, and it's easy to identify with a range of views on how strategic matches should be evaluated. On the one hand, even if the motives are mixed, helping behaviors often add value to others, increasing the total amount of giving in a social system. On the other hand, as we saw with Ken Lay, our behaviors leak traces of our motives. If recipients and witnesses of our giving begin to question whether the motives are self-serving, they are less likely to respond with gratitude or elevation. When strategic matchers engage in disingenuous efforts to help others primarily for personal gain, they may be hoisted by their own petard. Fellow matchers may withhold help, spread negative reputational information, or find other ways to impose a taker tax. To avoid these consequences, would-be matchers may be best served by giving in ways that they find enjoyable to recipients whose well-being matters to them. That way, even if they don't reap direct or karmic rewards, matchers will be operating in a giver's mindset, leading their motives to appear and become more pure. Ultimately, by repeatedly making the choice to act in the interest of others, strategic matchers may find themselves developing giver identities, resulting in a gradual drift in style toward the giving end of the reciprocity spectrum. We spend the majority of our waking hours at work. This means that what we do at work becomes a fundamental part of who we are. If we reserve giver values for our personal lives, what will be missing in our professional lives? By shifting ever so slightly in the giver direction, we might find our waking hours marked by greater success, richer meaning, and more lasting impact. Actions for impact. If you're interested in applying the principles in this book to your work or your life, I've compiled a set of practical actions that you can take. Many of these actions are based on the strategies and habits of successful givers, and in each case, I've provided resources and tools for evaluating, organizing, or expanding giving. Some of the steps focus on incorporating more giving into your daily behaviors. Others emphasize ways that you can fine-tune your giving, locate fellow givers, or engage others in giving. 1. Test your giver quotient. We often live in a feedback vacuum, deprived of knowledge about how our actions affect others. So that you can track your impact and assess your self-awareness, I've designed a series of free online tools. Visit www.givintake.com to take a free survey that tests your giver quotient. Along with filling out your own survey, you can invite people in your network to rate your reciprocity style, and you'll receive data on how often you're seen as a giver, taker, and matcher. 2. Run a reciprocity ring. What could be achieved in your organization and what giving norms would develop if groups of people got together weekly for 20 minutes to make requests and help one another fulfill them? For more information on how to start a reciprocity ring in your organization, visit Cheryl and Wayne Baker's company, Humax, www.humaxnetworks.com, which offers a suite of social networking tools for individuals and organizations. They've created materials to run a reciprocity ring in person and a Ripple Effect tool for running it online. People typically come together in groups of 15 to 30. Each person presents a request to the group members, who make contributions. They use their knowledge, resources, and connections to help fulfill the request. 3. Help other people craft their jobs or craft yours to incorporate more giving. People often end up working on tasks that aren't perfectly aligned with their interests and skills. A powerful way to give is to help others work on tasks that are more interesting, meaningful, or developmental. In 2011, a vice president named Jay at a large multinational retailer sent emails to each of his employees announcing a top secret mission, with details to be shared on a need-to-know basis in one-on-one meetings. When employees arrived individually for the meetings, Jay unveiled the confidential project. He asked them what they would enjoy doing that might also be of interest to other people. He inquired about their hobbies and personal interests, and what they would love to spend more time doing at the company. He then sent them out into the company to pursue their mission with 3 rules. It has to: 1. Appeal to at least one other person. 2. Be low or no cost. And 3. Be initiated by you. Throughout the year, Jay checked in to see how the secret missions were going. About 2/3 of his employees had made some effort toward making their visions a reality, and roughly half of those employees succeeded in launching them. One of Jay's favorite missions resulted in a book club where employees read books and discussed topics that were of personal interest and relevance to their jobs. People had permission to do all of that stuff before I ever asked that question, Jay reflects. But somehow, asking that question in my role gives people permission to pursue their interests in a way they didn't have before. It's planting seeds, with some percentage of them turning into real initiatives. These seeds have bloomed for many of his employees, and for Jay as well. In 2012, he was selected to become the vice president of ours for a major division of his company, where he's responsible for more than 45,000 employees. In the secret missions, Jay encouraged his employees to engage in job crafting, a concept introduced by Amy Rosisniewski and Jane Dutton, management professors at Yale and the University of Michigan, respectively. Job crafting involves innovating around a job description, creatively adding and customizing tasks and responsibilities to match personal interests and values. A natural concern is that people might craft their jobs in ways that fail to contribute to their organizations. To address this question, Amy, Justin Berg, and I partnered with Jennifer Kirkoski and Brian Well, who run a people and innovation lab at Google. In a study across the United States and Europe, we randomly assigned Google employees working in sales, finance, operations, accounting, marketing, and human resources to a job crafting workshop. The employees created a map of how they'd like to modify their tasks, crafting a more ideal, but still realistic vision of their jobs that aligned with their interests and values. 6 weeks later, their managers and coworkers rated them as significantly happier and more effective. Many Google employees found ways to spend more time on tasks that they found interesting or meaningful. Some delegated unpleasant tasks, and others were able to customize their jobs to incorporate new knowledge and skills that they wanted to develop. All told, Google employees found their work more enjoyable and were motivated to perform better, and in some cases, these gains lasted for 6 months. Job crafting worked across reciprocity styles. Givers, takers, and matchers all became more effective. The givers saw job crafting as an opportunity to expand their impact, so they generated ways to add more value to other people in the company, such as mentoring junior colleagues, creating better products for clients, and improving training for new hires. The matchers were grateful for the opportunity to pursue more meaningful and interesting work, and reciprocated by working harder. Even the takers recognized that to advance their own careers, they needed to craft their jobs in ways that would benefit the company as well as themselves. To help people craft their jobs, Justin, Amy, and Jane have developed a tool called the Job Crafting Exercise. It's what we use to conduct the Google workshops, and it involves creating a before sketch of how you currently allocate your time and energy, and then developing a visual after diagram of how you'd like to modify your job. 4. Start a love machine. In many organizations, givers go unrecognized. To combat this problem, organizations are introducing peer recognition programs to reward people for giving in ways that leaders and managers rarely see. A Mercer study found that in 2001, about 25% of large companies had peer recognition programs, and by 2006, this number had grown to 35%, including celebrated companies like Google, Southwest Airlines, and Zappos. A fascinating approach called the Love Machine was developed at Linden Lab, the company behind the virtual world Second Life. In a high technology company, many employees aim to protect their time for themselves and guard information closely instead of sharing their time and knowledge with colleagues. The Love Machine was designed to overcome this tendency by enabling employees to send a love message when they appreciated help from a colleague. The love messages were visible to others, rewarding and recognizing giving by linking it to status and reputations. One insider viewed it as a way to get tech geeks to compete to see who could be the most helpful. Love helped boost awareness of people who did tasks that were sometimes overlooked. Our support staff, for instance, often received the most love, says Chris Colosi, a former Linden manager. Once you introduce a certain percentage of takers into your system, you need to think about what effect an incentive will have, but I enjoyed the idea of love for tasks that were outside of someone's job description or requirements. 5. Embrace the 5-minute favor. If you visit a 106 miles meetup, you might see Panda Adam Rifkin in top form. He's a master of the 5-minute favor, and you can follow Panda's lead by asking people what they need and looking for ways to help at a minimal personal cost. Rifkin's two favorite offers are to give honest feedback and make an introduction. For example, here's a simple exercise to get started as a connector. Start by going through your Rolodex, LinkedIn, or Facebook network. Identify pairs of people who share an uncommon commonality. Then, pick one pair a week and introduce them by email. Rifkin also recommends reconnecting with dormant ties, not to get something, but to give. Once a month, reach out to one person with whom you haven't spoken in years. Find out what they're working on, and ask if there are ways that you can be helpful. On a related note, you can learn more about David Hornick's 6. Practice powerless communication, but become an advocate. Developing greater comfort and skill with powerless communication requires a change in habits from talking to listening, self-promoting to advice-seeking, and advocating to inquiring. Jim Quigley, a senior partner at Deloitte who previously served as CEO, decided to work on his powerless communication. He set a goal in meetings to talk no more than 20% of the time. One of my objectives is listening. Many times, you can have bigger impact if you know what to ask rather than knowing what to say. I don't learn anything when I'm speaking. I learn a lot when I'm listening, Quigley told me. As he shifted from answers toward questions, Quigley found himself gaining a deeper understanding of other people's needs. It doesn't come naturally to everyone, but it's a habit, and you can form that habit. For more on the power of powerless communication, at the same time, it's important to make sure that powerless communication doesn't come at the expense of assertiveness when advocating for others' interests and our own. Get Raised is a free resource that offers advice on negotiating salary increases. According to co-founder Matt Wallet, the average pay increase is $6,726, provided that you're underpaid. 7. Join a community of givers. To find other givers, join a free circle community to give away goods and see what other people need. www.freecircle.org. Another inspiring community of givers is Service Space, www.servicespace.org, the home of a series of giftivism initiatives started by Nippon Mita. Headquartered in Berkeley, California, Service Space has over 400,000 members and sends over 50 million emails a year. Yet they still operate by three rules: no staff, no fundraising, and no strings attached. Through Service Space, Nippon has created a platform for people to increase their giver quotients, divided into three categories: gift economy projects, inspirational content, and volunteer and non-profit support. One of the gift economy projects is Karma Kitchen, where the menu has no prices. When the bill arrives, it reads $0 and contains just two sentences: your meal was a gift from someone who came before you. To keep the chain of gifts alive, we invite you to pay it forward for those who dine after you. Another gift economy project is HelpOthers.org, which collects stories of people playing give a tag, do something anonymously for someone else, and leave a smile card inviting them to pay it forward. Nippon describes how one woman at a Fortune 500 company went to get a drink from the vending machine and put extra change in with a note: your drink has been paid for by someone you don't know. Spread the love. Then, she brought in donuts and left another smile card behind. A guy noticed this trend, and he decides to send an email to the whole building, Nippon says, laughing. The guy writes, "I've been trying to track them down for a long time, and I think it's between floors 2 and 3. Now everybody's on alert for kindness, and a bunch of people start doing it. On the Service Space website, you can order smile cards, help support non-profit causes, subscribe to the weekly newsletter, or read a thought-provoking list of ways to give, such as paying the toll for the person behind you, or thanking people for helping you by writing a complimentary note to their boss. The more you give, the more you want to do it, as do others around you. It's like going to the gym," Nippon says. "If you've been working out your kindness muscles, you get stronger at it." Another impressive initiative is Hope Mob, billed as the place where generous strangers unite to bring immediate hope to people with pressing needs all over the world. http://hopemob.org. For ideas about how to organize your own group of people to perform random acts of kindness, see the initiatives underway at Extreme Kindness in Canada, http://extremakindness.com, and the Kindness Offensive in the UK, http://thekindnessoffensive.com. The Kindness Offensive is a group of people who strive to be aggressively helpful, organizing some of the grandest random acts of kindness in human history. They've provided a toy for every child in a hospital in London, given away 500,000 pancakes, distributed tons of giveaways at festivals around Britain, provided free medical supplies and housing support to families in need, and hosted tea parties for elderly people, obtained an electric guitar for a 10-year-old boy, and landed free front row seats and behind-the-scenes training at the Moscow Circus for a father hoping to surprise his daughter. It may be no coincidence that the founder's name is David Goodfellow. You might also be intrigued by BNI. www.bni.com. Ivan Misner's business networking organization with the motto of "Givers Gain." as well as the GoGiver community. www.thegajiva.com/community, a group of people who read the GoGiver fable by Bob Berg and John David Mann, and decided that giving would be a powerful way to live their professional lives. 8. Launch a personal generosity experiment. If you'd rather give on your own, try the Good 30 Day Challenge. www.goodpointer.com/the-good-30-day-challenge. Become a good citizen. Each day for a month, Good suggests a different way to give. For more examples of random acts of kindness, check out Sasha Dichter's 30 Day Generosity Experiment and Ryan Garsha's Year of Daily Random Acts of Kindness. Dichter, the chief innovation officer at the Acumen Fund, embarked on a month-long generosity experiment in which he said yes to every request for help that he received. Garsha, a sales executive at ZocDoc, is performing one random act of kindness every day for an entire year, and keeping a blog about his experience, from stepping up as a mentor to thanking a customer service representative. As we saw in Chapter 6, this generosity experiment is likely to be most psychologically rewarding if you spend somewhere between 2 and 11 hours a week on it, and if you distribute it into larger chunks, multiple acts once a week, instead of one act every day. 9. Help fund a project. Many people are seeking financial support for their projects on Kickstarter. www.kickstarter.com, known as the world's largest funding platform for creative projects, you can find people looking for help in designing and launching movies, books, video games, music, plays, paintings, and other products and services. On Kiva, www.kiva.org, you can identify opportunities to make microloans of $25 or more to entrepreneurs in the developing world. Both sites give you the chance to see and follow the progress of the people you help. 10. Seek help more often. If you want other people to be givers, one of the easiest steps is to ask. When you ask for help, you're not always imposing a burden. Some people are givers, and by asking for help, you're creating an opportunity for them to express their values and feel valued. By asking for a 5-minute favor, you impose a relatively small burden, and if you ask a matcher, you can count on having an opportunity to reciprocate. Wayne and Cheryl Baker note that people can start the spark of reciprocity by making requests as well as helping others. Help generously and without thought of return, but also ask often for what you need. If you enjoyed this video and want to hear it again, be sure to click the subscribe button and also click the notification bell to switch between getting all notifications, and like and share. Leave your comment and suggestions below. Thank you for watching.